Jesus Christ, we're going to do that in several different ways. We're going to do it in singing. We're going to do it in prayer. We're going to do it in preaching. Looking forward to all of it. Any way we can lift up the Lord Jesus Christ, He earns it, and we owe it all to Him. And glad to be just a small part of it. Again, welcome. And we're going to just sing out of the good old church hymnal. So if we'll all stand and turn into our church hymnal to page 235. Once like a bird in prison I dwelled, no freedom from my sorrow I felt. But Jesus came and listened to me, and glory to God, He set me free. He set me free, yes, He set me free. And from the bond of prison for me, my glory bound, my Jesus to see. Glory to God, He set me free. Now I am climbing higher each day. Darkness has drifted away. My feet are planted on higher ground. In glory to God, I'm homeward bound. He set me free. He set me free. And from the bond of prison for me, I'm glory bound by Jesus to see. For glory to God, goodbye to sin and things that confound. Not of the world shall turn me around. Daily I'm working, I'm praying to. And glory to God, I'm going through. He set me free, yeah. He set me free. From the bond of prison for me, I'm glory bound. Amen. Y'all be seated. Amen. Praise Him.
I think it's my turn at this point. Let me first say welcome to you. We appreciate you being here at Mount Carmel Baptist Church, and appreciate Awake 21 letting us host tonight. It's an honor for us to do so. If you need to use the restrooms, there are some right out here in the hallway. There are some waters out there as well. If you want to pick up water, you're welcome to that. We have some greeters here. If you need directions, they'll give you directions. You just ask somebody, but the restrooms are here. There are, if you're in, I guess, in real bad shape, there's some restrooms down the hallway. But whatever. But we're glad to have you with us. We're glad to be able to worship the Lord together tonight. Listen, I am glad that Jesus saved me, and I hope you are too. And we're here to lift up the name of Jesus Christ in all we do. Appreciate Brother Richard Turney being here tonight as well. I'll introduce him here in a little bit. We're glad to have him with us. Excited to hear him bring the Word of God to us tonight. Somebody else that's here tonight is Judge Dave Dugan. And Dave Dugan is also here with us tonight. We're glad to have David and Anita, but David Dugan is here with us tonight, and he is representing the Faith and Family Coalition, and he'll tell you a little bit about what they are, maybe, but he's going to share just a little bit tonight. So if you would come at this time and share what the Lord.
I've been taking a little bit different approach this year. I haven't talked in detail about faith and family every night. I did last night, and I will again before this series is over, because I don't want to assume that everybody here knows about faith and family. Some of you, I'm sure, were not in these services last year, and maybe you don't. But I want to say something that's related to faith and family. It has to do with why we formed. But first of all, I want to also welcome you in behalf of the Faith and Family Coalition. It's a real pleasure for me to be at Mount Carmel. I know it is for you too, but now we're in the neighborhood, general neighborhood, the area where my mother grew up. So it's always, we used to come down through here every single Sunday. When I was a boy, we would visit my grandparents on Mint Road, and then we'd come over this way and visit my grandparents on Old Niles Ferry, and that was a Sunday ritual. And every now and then, we'd get to stop at Kay's Ice Cream on the way home, and that's a good memory, too. But I'm not going to talk about faith and family per se tonight, but what I want to say is a follow-up to what I said about faith and family last night with respect to why the organization was formed. And it's also a little bit of a follow-up to what Mickey Rainwater preached on last night, although he certainly doesn't need me to comment on his sermon. But I want to start with this scripture where Jesus himself spoke about the tension that exists between the church, the universal church, and the world. And it's John 15, verses 18 to 19. If the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. That's kind of a harsh thing to think about, isn't it? But that's what Jesus Christ said. For me, there was a lot of good things about Mickey's sermon last night, but there's one thing he said that for me was a real gem. And I've been thinking about it a lot in recent weeks, in recent months. I've even written some things myself about it. For maybe some point in time, I'll have an opportunity to share that. And I'd love to hear him preach a part two where he expounds on this idea. He said last night that the church is countercultural. You remember that up in Townsend? He said that there is friction between the church and the world. And that's as it should be, as we just saw in John. I think that that's a profound statement that he offered us last night. One that speaks to the age in which we live, and one that we should reflect upon and meditate upon. I've tried to use that principle, perhaps without much success, in some of my discussions with people that I love within the Methodist Church, but whom I believe are misguided in this struggle that my church is going through right now over human sexuality and marriage. And I would ask you to continue to pray for my church, the Methodist Church, also Alcoa First Methodist. If we stand on God's Word and our Christian heritage, shouldn't there be some tension between what we believe and profess and what the world proclaims? Shouldn't there be some tension? And didn't Jesus himself tell us that that is the case? And so, if we find that when we embrace the world and what it proclaims, we become more welcome in the world, and there is less tension between the world and the church, isn't that evidence that something is very deeply wrong within the church? So I encourage all of us to think about that. Progressive ideology now dominates almost all of our institutions, academia, big business, public education, maybe not here, but in some places, the news media, entertainment, even professional athletics. Every institution except the church, and it has a strong foothold there. Shouldn't that tell us something is very deeply wrong and false within the church. The church and the triune God, that's what we have. That's not only what we have left, if you want to look at it that way, it's what we have to offer. It's what we have to offer the world. And we must contend for the church and for God. I want to thank Mount Carmel and Pastor Scott Linkenfelter for hosting us. It's very deeply appreciated, and let's worship the eternal, unchanging God together.
Okay, so let me make announcements, a couple of announcements here, and then we'll worship the Lord. As many Mount Carmel people as can, come sit in the choir, will you? And so what we'll do is all of the Mount Carmel folks are at this time going to move to the choir, and all you guests who are sitting in some metal chairs, you come get some of these nice padded pews, all right? Y'all are guests, and we want you to have a nice, good place to sit, so our folks are going to move up here and give up some seats for you. Thank you, Mount Carmel, for doing that. You guys are welcome to move up here. We'll move around a little bit while while we got some moving parts here. We'll get turn it over to Curtis, and Curtis Marshall will lead us in some song this evening. Thank you.
Amen. Good problem to have. We got to move around a little bit. Good problem to have. It's because y'all come out to serve the Lord. Hey, awesome. He deserves a hand clap of praise. Amen. All right, we're going to jump right back into it. Y'all feel like standing or sitting? I think y'all feel like standing, don't you? In our church hymnal, let's turn to page 240. Page 240, when the roll is called up yonder. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and times shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the Saviors together over on the other shore, and the roll called up yonder out of the air. When the roll is called up yonder, page 285.
turn right over to page 333.
Some glad
glad to hear y'all singing. Hey, beautiful. Good to come out to the house of the Lord and have the freedom to fellowship and lift up the name of Jesus in any way. And that was awesome. I was down here earlier today. I just started thinking about how good the Lord is and how far he brought me. And there was a song that I hadn't heard since I was a little kid. For some reason, don't know why it came to my head, Lord. But it's a song that I don't even remember exactly how it goes, but it was something that goes along the lines of, "He's still working on me." You remember singing that as a little kid? And ain't you glad he's not done working on us? Ain't you glad you ain't who you used to be? And that he's still able to keep us going forward, improving and getting close to the Lord. He's still working on me to make me who I ought to be. He made the earth, moon, and the sun in 6 days or something. I don't remember. But he's still working on me. Hey. He's still working on, it's a good Lord, not where I used to be. And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that he gave us the greatest gift when we didn't deserve it. So we're going to sing a little bit here. If y'all know the words of this, just sing. Just sing. It's called Graves in the Gardens. I searched the world it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Now every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Yeah, Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you see them all. You still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace will find me again. Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one. Nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn graves into gardens, you turn bones into armies. Turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
Amen. At this time, it's my privilege to introduce to you Brother Richard Turney. And Brother Richard is the pastor at Rest Haven Baptist Church over in Alcoa. The church has been there a long time. Brother Richard's been there longer than the church. He has been the pastor there for 30 years, he said. And I appreciate that and admire that. Let me take just a second. This is my dad here, and my dad was a pastor all my life, and pastored churches just most every. He didn't pastor many churches. He stayed there a long time. Stayed double digit years about everywhere he went. And I came to Mount Carmel, and I followed a guy that had been here 28 years. Brother Clifton's here somewhere. I don't know where, but we may put him in the basement. I don't know. He's here somewhere. Brother Clifton, Miss Mayer here. Brother Clifton was a pastor here for 28 years. And I've been here 18. They're gluttons for punishment around here. I know that Rest Haven is blessed to have Brother Richard. And we are blessed and honored to have him tonight. His wife Doris with him as well. Thank you guys for coming. Thank you for bringing the word to us tonight. It's an honor and it's a privilege. We look forward to hearing the word. And then if you want to have an altar call afterward, feel free to do so, Brother Richard. You just take it from here, all right? Let me introduce to you at this time, Brother Richard Turney.
Amen, amen. I like getting the preliminaries out of the way. I want to thank my lovely wife for coming with me tonight, Doris. She's put up with me for 40 years, and amen. Pray for her. Amen. Thank God for the Wake 21. I remember, thank God for Pastor Scott Lingenfelter, Mount Carmel, for the invite and the hospitality. I remember 3 years ago or 4 years ago, Pastor Ronnie Hepperly called me, and he talked to me about us. And we weren't even talking about Wake 21. We was talking about forming a prayer group with pastors. And we were on, it's about nine of us, I think, that we originally started with. And we just agreed we were going to come together. And I remember distinctly telling Pastor Ronnie, I don't want to come with talk about religion. I don't want to come talk about no denomination. And I don't even want to talk about color. I just want to talk about Jesus. And Pastor Ronnie said, that's a good thing. We'll be able to do that. Well, you can count me in. So, amen. Amen. Because I believe when we get to glory, God is not going to be looking at some of the stuff we look at. Being he looks at the heart. Amen. And so we thank God for that. And thank God for this choir. Amen. And thank God for two of my special friends, Billy and Dana, on there. They are a blessing. Amen. I mean, they're a blessing. I just love them to death. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Let us go before the Lord in a moment of prayer. We're going to take our message this evening from St. John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Amen. Let us go before the Lord. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we invite you, we invoke you, we desire you, and we seek you. Lord, we understand, Lord, without you, we can't do nothing. So breathe on me. Breathe on us. Quicken, stir that reviving, fresh anointing that, Lord, our ears will be in tune, our hearts will be pricked, and we'll walk like the Emmaus boys. Didn't our heart burn while the word of God was broken unto us? Bless us in our coming and going. Bless Mount Carmel. Bless Awake 21. But bless this time we have that the Spirit of the living God has sovereign rulership in our lives and in this moment, that he gets total glory, for in him we live and move and have our being. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. St. John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, we always at Rest Haven ask you to stand for the word of God. We stand for a lot of stuff. We ought to stand for Jesus, amen. St. John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Amen, amen. St. John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. You'll find these words. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And we just want to take our thought from three words. In the beginning. In the beginning, you may be seated. Listen, church, beginning and end are vastly different. And only one can we choose to make a change in, and that's our ending. You see, beginning is the starting point. The first, in the natural, it's our first birth. And somehow or another, we live in a time and day where we put so much emphasis in the natural that we water down the spiritual. Amen. But how many know Jesus has got another birth that he set up for us? Because we couldn't stay faithful in the natural because of our flawed state. Amen. And so we had to experience a new birth. But this new birth didn't come in the natural, it came from above. But ending refers to finalization, completion, finishing, or fulfillment. And it points more to what we'll call the new birth. So you see, in the beginning, I was and you were conceived in iniquity. We were already in a fallen state from our first man, Adam. Sin. But in the end, we can be born again into our second Adam, a quickening spirit, a new creature in Christ. Are you with me? I'm talking about in the beginning. Some come with me, if you will, in our imaginary mind and look back into the biblical archives of time and step into the stable and cradle in your arms the baby Jesus, still warm from the womb, just wrapped in swaddling clothes, run your finger across his cheek and listen as one who knows him well put a phrase to his life. In the beginning was the Word. St. John 1:1. Catch this. The words in the beginning take us to the beginning, Genesis 1:1. You all remember the Bible said the earth was without form and void, and Jesus didn't change positions, he just spoke. Amen. How many know there's power in the Word? He just spoke, and because he was the existing Word, he didn't have to change anything. He just spoke to it out of what he was and what it became. How many know some of us got to get some Word in us? We got to get some Word in us because we speak a lot of stuff, but we don't speak what God spoke. But we expect God to bless it. God can't bless anything outside of who he is. If you want to get what God wants and what God desires, you're going to have to speak like God spoke. And when you speak it, you can't just rehearse it. You got to speak it like you believe it. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Mary held the baby that was connected to the dawn of time. He saw and was the first ray of sunlight. You see, the baby was born, but the Word never was. It always was. Listen, church, 1 Corinthians 8:6, all things were made through him, not by him, but through him. Jesus didn't fashion things out of raw material. He found or discovered, he created everything out of nothing. Jesus, the Genesis Word, the firstborn over all creation, Colossians 1:15, he is the one Lord Jesus Christ through whom all things were created and through we live. Can I help somebody? We don't start living until we are born again. Outside of that, we just existing. Anybody ever thought about it? What benefit is it to be born and then die? You see, no theologian conceived, no rabbi dared dream what God alone did. The Word became flesh. St. John 1:14, God became an embryo in the belly of a village girl, Christ in Mary, God in Christ, and then had enough love to put the Holy Spirit in us. Taking me out of nothing, dying in a dying world, sin infested, and offered me something I didn't deserve. It was called grace. And fashioning in me love, he washed me, He purified me. He sanctified me. He made me and you a new born again creature. Remember, while we were yet sinners, he chose in himself to die in the beginning. It was always his plan. Can anybody tell God thank you? I'm glad that God looked over the balconies and the bowels of time, saw me a mess that I was, and he said, I'm going to send a redeemer. I'm going to send a ransom to pay the price. You can't get it right. You can't fix it up. You can't straighten it up. I'm going to send you my son. He was born by a virgin Mary, and he was overshadowed by the Holy Spirit. I'm going to send you some anointing that's going to destroy the yoke. In the beginning was the Word. Word was with God, and the Word was God. Same was in the beginning with God. Church, hear me. We need to go back to the beginning. Amen. We've made progression. We've made some advancements. We've got some great technology. We've got smarter people. We've got better technology. We got a lot of advanced things. But what has happened, we moved away from the beginning. Jesus ain't never changed positions. He's the same, said, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. The problem is we move so much apart from God that we have made ourselves God. I'm not talking about big G. I'm talking about little G. We made ourselves our own God. So we come to say, well, you need to look to here, and you need to depend on here, and you need to rely on here. We don't need to do that. We need to go back to Jesus. All things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. Church, hear me. The Word said everything God made it. That means people who are confused living these strange way of life, God made them, but he didn't make them like they think. Amen. People said, I've got an addiction problem. God made them, he just didn't make them addicted. People who lie, God made them, but he didn't make them a liar. They chose to get out of the bounds of God and became. But how many know God loves us so much that he doesn't change positions, that whosoever will, if you will come back to God and don't try to fix it up, don't try to straighten it up, in the beginning, God, just come back to God like you are and let God do what only God can do in you. In him was life. Life was the light of men. Don't you know the most powerful folk in the world are those who radiate the light of Jesus? Jesus, when he come to give you life. Amen. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended not. I agree with you, Judge Dugan. The reason why the world hates us, because we got the light on. Amen. See, when you walk in who you are in Christ, your light is shining. See, when you stand by faith and against the opposition, your light is shining. You see, when the world says you need to bend, but you won't bend, your light is shining. You see, when the world says we can do this, but you say, no, prayer changes things, your light is shining. We need to learn to let our light. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Same came for witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. All we're trying to do is bring folk to where the light is shining. I'm not the light. I'm just a reflector to just show them where the light is shining at. Amen. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Everybody who comes into Christ gets the light. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Somebody say, he gave you power. Amen. You ain't weak. You just need to get closer to God and use what he's given you. He's given you power. Amen. Power over the enemy. Power over darkness. Power over lies. Power over trouble. Even power over sickness. The thing is, God has given you some power that you've got at your disposal. And you know where the power is? It's in the Word. See, if you get more Word in you, you get more power. And you get more faith, because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And you get more of that, and you can tell some stuff what you needed to do.
You can decree a thing and it'll establish. You can call things and be not as though they were. You can pray by faith and the Spirit will move on your behalf. You can lift up holy hands even when the world is against you, because in God I live.
God, I'll die. I got power. Which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. I was born messed up. I don't know about y'all. Y'all might have had it all together, but I was born messed up. I was born messed up. But when Jesus came to rescue me, he didn't ask me to quit doing what I did. He just told me to come to him. I was flawed and on my way to hell and didn't even know it. But Jesus loved me so much that he loved the hell right out of me. Jesus had the greatest risk. He called me a son before I came into sonship. He called you a daughter before you came into daughtership. Don't you know that God already looked past your mess and he saw where you were and met your need? God loves us too much to leave us where we are. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bear witness, said, this was he of whom I spake. He's coming after me, and I can't even untie his shoes. And of his fullness have all received grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. And y'all know the story. Amen. Moses was the lawgiver. Moses was given the law. But how many know Moses, all he could do was show you where you messed up. Jesus had to go to the cross to make a way for you. Amen. Grace came through Jesus Christ. But he fulfilled the law by paying the debt. Amen. And let me tell you something. And some of us have watered down the story. Some of us have lost the joy of what Jesus did. Let me tell you, Jesus, the Bible said he came down through 42 generations. The Bible said he wrapped himself in the womb of Mother Mary. The Bible said that in that he was born in a manger because there wasn't no room for him in the inn. The Bible said that wise men, and we say three, but the Bible said wise men came to see where Jesus was laid at. They brought him gifts. Amen. And the Bible said Jesus got to be at the age of 12, and his mother, and he got displaced from his parents. And the Bible said they noticed he wasn't with them for a day's journey and went back to look for their baby. And they found him. And I know she's like any mother. She said, honey, I've been looking for you. And his response was, mother, no disrespect, but I must be about my father's business. The Bible said as he got to be up in his 30s, he started doing some miraculous things. How many know miracles are still available? He turned water into wine. He started the first food campaign. He took 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish and fed 5,000 men beside women and children. Amen. He raised a boy out of a coffin and gave him back to his mother. He caused a lame man to get up and start walking. Amen. He called a woman that had a troubled past, but Jesus met her at the well, and all he did was talk to her where she was and not talk about her. The woman received Jesus, and the stuff she used to depend on, she left it because she was so full of the Holy Spirit. She ran into town to tell his disciples, come see a man who told me all things about myself. Is this not the very Christ? Amen. But the Bible said that Jesus came down there for one mission. He came to die on a cross. He came down here to give his life so you and I can live.
The Bible said they run nails in his hands and nails in his feet and hung him high and stretched him wide. But the night before they beat him so bad, you couldn't even recognize him. Isn't that something? They beat the Word because they didn't like what the Word had to say. How many know we live in a day where folk are trying to beat up the Word because they don't like what the Word has got to say? But I don't want to leave you in the grave. That means that the Word had an end. Let me tell you, they took him down off that cross and they wrapped him in cloths and they put him in a borrowed tomb. How many know the only one's got a borrowed tomb's named Jesus? You and I will have a marker. They placed him in a borrowed tomb, and all night Friday, there nothing seemed to happen. All day Saturday, nothing seemed to happen. All night Saturday, nothing seemed to happen. It didn't seem to happen on our end, but Jesus was always working. How many know he went down to hell and got the keys from the adversary and told him, all authority and power has been given unto me. And understand this, while he was doing that, he was getting ready for getting up morning. Because the Bible said when Resurrection Sunday came, he took and folded up the cloth at the head and laid it neatly. He took the cloth around his body and laid it on the other end. And the Bible said when he took and moved the rock that tried to hold the rock, he stepped out of eternity back into time and looked up toward heaven, and he made one bold declaration. All power, earth and heaven, is in my hand. So listen to me, church. He got enough power to save anybody. And then he got enough power to heal anybody. He got enough power to raise the dead. Then he got enough power to call the dead back to life. He got enough power to open blinded eyes. He got enough power to silence the mouths of the adversary. He got enough power to part a Red Sea. And he got enough power to drive you over on dry land. He's got the power. Aren't you glad that I got a beginning? Aren't you glad I can go back and I can get connected? Aren't you glad that even in my worst, he's still at his best? I can go back and get connected. In the beginning. I mean, God's plan is for every man to be saved. In the beginning. I don't want nobody to miss this opportunity. In the beginning, God. God said, whosoever will, let him come. God don't care how you come. He don't care how you get here. He just said, come. And you ought to come to Jesus, and you ought to be in a hurry. Well, I've been in church for a long time, brother preacher. I didn't ask you to come be churchy. I asked you to come to Christ. See, the problem is we come with methods how to build the church, but not build the kingdom. You can do a lot of stuff to get your numbers up, but you can only do one thing to get the soul right. You can do a lot of stuff to make folk happy, but you can only do one thing to give them joy. You can do a lot of stuff to make people speak well of what all you have, but you can do only one thing that's going to make a difference in their life. And I need you to understand the only difference is the Word of God. Amen. He said in the beginning, all things are possible to them who believe. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. You of God, little children, have overcome them. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen. Love the Lord thy God with all heart, soul, mind, body, and strength. Second is not the least. Love your neighbor like you love yourself. Help somebody. You can't put the second before the first. If you don't love God, you can't love your neighbor.
peace I give to you, not as the world giveth I give unto you, but my peace I give to you past all understanding. My grace is sufficient. My mercies are new every morning. We walk by faith and not by sight. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. No, I'm more than a conqueror and an overcomer through Christ Jesus who give me my strength. I wonder how many blessed folk in here. I wonder how many know without a shadow of doubt God been better to you than you've been to yourself. How many can tell God, thank you, I'm alive one more time. Thank you, even in my worst, God, you didn't give up on me. Thank you, when I was almost counted out, you woke me back in. Thank you, I was bound and almost tied up, but God set me free. Word can't come back void. Amen. The word can't come back void. If you throw it out there, maybe you don't catch nothing this time. But keep on throwing it out there. Amen. Because God is true to his promise. And the more you keep casting, the more you keep casting, don't change it, cast it. And the more you cast it, one day, God is going to put a hook in something that's going to bring you a breakthrough. But you're going to have to believe on the front end that what God has for you, it's planned and it's purposed, because God promised it in his word. I can't understand. I'm closing now, but I can't understand how come the church is so unhappy. I can't understand how come the church seems to be disarrayed. I can't understand how come the church seems to be on the tail end and the world is leading. I just can't understand it. Well, I come to a conclusion, maybe we've lost our fondness for the word. And if we lost our fondness for the word, then we don't look no different than the world. Jesus ordained us, set us apart, and sanctified us to be the head, not the tail. They don't have no right to tell us when they don't know where they're going. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come unto the Father but by. Why should we be following them and they don't know where they're going? If God has put the word in you, you ought to be running ahead of them. Well, what if they don't run with me? I ain't trying to get them to run with me. I'm trying to get them to see that the race is not given to the swift, neither to the strong, but those of us endure and hold out to the end. I'm running a race because I'm playing to win. I'm running a race because I'm on the winning side. I'm running a race. It might not look real pretty, might not look good, but I know where I'm going to arrive at. And I don't know about y'all, I'm not running because I want to look good here, because I know my reward is over in glory. And if God set it up for me, I ain't going to let nothing separate me from the love of God. Nothing. Nothing. Persecution, tribulation, nothing should separate you from the love of God. If you're in love with God, you're in love with the best lover you can find. And one thing about Jesus, you love him, he'll love you back. Amen. What a joy it is to have Jesus on our side. And the conclusion is, what can man do unto me? Can't do nothing. Amen. Well, they might talk about me, but I'm still going to win. He might call me out of my character, but I'm still going to win. He might even deny me some stuff down here, but I'm not after his stuff. I'm still going to win. He might tell me I ain't worthy, but I'm not trying to get under him. I'm trying to get under the blood. I'm still going to win. He might tell me that I ain't gonna never accomplish nothing. But that's all right, because in Christ, I'm still gonna win. And when the dust is settled and the roll is called, I don't know about y'all, but I plan to hear my name called and one statement said, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. Come on up and enter into the joy of the Lord." Amen. Amen. In the beginning. Church, let's come back to the beginning. And listen, it don't matter what our denomination is. You can be Baptist, Methodist, Protestant, whatever you want to be. But you need to make sure you're in Jesus. Because Jesus ain't doing denominational roll call. No, he Pentecostals, and he ain't doing that. You're either saved or you're lost. You ain't going no middle place. Heaven or hell. Both of them have eternal stamps on them. If you've been through enough down here, it don't make no sense. You're going to say, "I'll just live the rest of my life, die, and then hope for the best." I got news for you. The best ain't the best. An eternal hell, amen, for going through hell. That's not good math. I can't escape some of the stuff we got to go through down here, but I doggone sure make sure I'm going to escape it when I get before Jesus. Amen. In the beginning, God. Amen. You ain't got to argue. In the beginning, God. In the beginning, God. People are always wanting to challenge me. I said, "Listen, let's go see what God got to say." But why you always got to bring him in it? That's the only one I can bring in it. Don't need to hear from me. Let's talk and see what he got to say. And you know what? One by one, they like them boys that accuse that girl. They do the usher wave. They, one by one, they excuse themselves. You know why? Because they ain't got no word, and you standing on word. Church, you want folk to get right, stand on the word of God and let God do the work. Because listen, when you stand on the word, that's faith. When you act in the word, that's faith. When you walk in the word, that's faith. And people will see the power of God in you, and it'll cause them come under conviction. Because many people know somebody somewhere. And when they find out that you are with Jesus and you are what you are, it gives them hope that God can use them too. In the beginning, God. We want to extend an invitation, amen. It ain't fair to tell people, because you've been in church, you're on your way to heaven. I've seen a whole lot of people that have been in church. They didn't make it to heaven. They were good church people, but they never met Christ. And it's foolish on my part. I do it at funeral. Now, you don't know, somebody might need to make a decision even when a loved one's gone. The key is I got to make sure you with Jesus. However we got to do it. And amen, tonight's a good night. You might have been partnering with Awake 21. You might have been coming and been coming for a while, but you ain't made a decision for Jesus yet. I want to extend an invitation to you and let you know you ain't got to do anything. Just come. Is there one today that ain't sure if tonight was your night? If tonight was your night, you're not sure if you're going to have a home in eternity. Amen. This ain't got nothing to do with age. This got to do with your heart with Christ. If you're not sure, amen, you come on down. And if you're not comfortable in walking, raise your hand. I'll walk with you. That way they can laugh at both of us. Amen. Maybe you need somebody to pray with you. We got other pastors with Awake 21. We just want to pray with you. Ain't no need walking in here the same way you came. You ought to walk out of here better. Amen. You ought to walk out of here with some assurance. You ought to walk out of here with some peace in your situation. You ought not walk in here with the same baggage and walk out of here carrying it. You come into the presence of God who can carry it better than you can. Why don't you give it to him? Amen. Amen. Again, I thank Pastor Scott Lingenfelder. Thank Away 21. Let us pray to God and let us go before the Lord, and I'll yield it back over to those in charge. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you again tonight for what you've imparted, showered, showed us, and unveiled to us. Forgive us, Lord, but we've all come up short, but you ain't never missed out on of us or missed the mark. But thank you for grace. Thank you for your mercy. Now, Lord, marinate somebody's heart tonight that in their process they're thinking and pondering, what must I do to be saved? Tonight's a good night to come meet up with the Master. You ain't got to do nothing. Just come. God is the Savior. God has the gift. And God will make you whole again. We thank you now for this moment in this hour. Blessings over Mount Carmel. Blessings over Wake 21. Blessed we move forward in the divine appointment of Christ. We give ourselves over to you, and we trust you. It's in Jesus' name we do pray and give him thanks. Amen.
Would you stand with me? We're going to, the instruments are going to play. We're going to give you an opportunity to make a decision. If there's something you need to get right with the Lord tonight about, this is your chance to do so. This altar is open. There are pastors all over this building who'll be glad to pray with you. If you've never accepted Christ, would you come? Lost person, come and be saved and receive Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of your life. Have your sins forgiven and leave this place redeemed. Christian, if there's a burden on your heart you need to get right with the Lord about tonight, you can. If the Lord's speaking to your heart, you come. If you know the words to this song, you sing it with me. And if there's a decision that you need to make while we sing and while we pray, you just step out. If you're in the middle of an aisle, they'll let you out. If the Lord's dealing with your heart, you step out and come right now.